Hey Barry.
Hey.
Hey man, how are you?
Yeah, very good. You?
Yeah, good. Good. How's your day been? Productive?
No, chaotic. It's we're in full lockdown now, so it means kids are off school.
All
Which
right.
just, you know, it's just nuts.
Yeah, well, we're in the same position now, but at least the schools are closed because I think that's something people were. We're kind of hoping for a while until they realize they have to now homeschool their children. But yeah.
Yeah, it is what it is. I don't know, you know. It's yeah. I heard that Angela Merkel from Germany, she said that in her country it might be locked down until April or something. So I don't know if I can do it, man, till April with my kids at home. I
Yeah.
love them, but I'm yeah,
How many
losing
of
my
them?
patience. Two, just two, just two. That's enough.
I know it's part of your bio as well. You've got two huskies as well, I think.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
At least if you need a bit of peace and quiet, you can just take them out for a walk.
Yeah, that helps.
Yeah.
It does.
We've got two huskies here as well. They're not always that quiet.
Do they say, oh,
Yeah, we got one quiet one, one loud one.
Yeah. We have one that howls and the other one says ruff, ruff. And he's a really big one, but he just sounds like a girl.
Oh.
Yeah. But they're fun, aren't they?
Oh God, yeah. Yeah, they're adorable. A lot of walking, but that's a bonus.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's how I feel. Yeah. At least well, they're molting now, both of them. And that usually takes a while. Before they're and that's very hairy, as you know.
We were told they've molt twice a year. Sometimes ours molt all year round.
Yeah,
They just never
ours
seem
too.
to
Yeah, you just can keep on plucking. It doesn't matter, you know. You can
Yeah.
pluck a whole dog out of there, and then you can just keep on going. It's crazy.
Cool. I'm just going to let the room fill up. Normally tend to give it about 5 minutes before we
Yeah.
kick off. So yeah, no rush for you.
Are you going to record this?
Yeah, it's recording as we speak.
Okay, cool.
We're playing around with a slightly different time because I think this may be the first, because I know you're all in CET, so it's 7 o'clock for you. Normally we do an hour before, so just trying to have a bit of a play around and see how that affects numbers. But yeah, it's slightly
Okay.
before dinner time in the UK, so I can imagine probably more people in the UK.
Good evening, everybody.
Hello.
Hello, good evening.
I see there's a Belgian person there.
That
Denny,
Denny,
hey.
Yeah, I am. Hello. Nice to see
Hey.
you speaking. You have to speak at a virtual UK event to see you in the meeting. Oh, it's funny right now. It's
Yeah. I've been at Vizag though. Or what's it called?
yeah.
No, Wazag, Vizag, I don't know.
Yeah,
The
Fiza,
Belgian
yes.
one. Yeah.
Yeah, but they have a few. They have Azure, they have Fiza, they have Madden, they have a few, but they
Yeah.
have the Azure user group, the Visual Studio user group. So
Yeah,
maybe it
it's
was the Azure user group. Is it about Azure? I don't know.
they've got Cloud Brew as well, don't they? I think that takes
Yeah,
place.
there's a conference from Azure. I think Azure is yeah is the user group, and Cloud Brew is their major conference.
It takes place in
Also very funny.
an old brewery, doesn't
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, the Belgians do well in with technology events. They know how to do it.
No, over there.
Hello.
What time is it now?
Wait,
Oh, important.
depends on where
About
you
is
are.
and about 7 p.m.
Okay, not bad.
Not bad, no. Definitely not.
We've got someone over in North Carolina in the US.
Wow.
So yeah, not just a UK meetup. I think, to be honest, I think the majority of people in here are from Belgium or the Netherlands anyway, usually. So yeah, I see a few familiar faces in there, but yeah, it's international, not just UK.
That's the fun with virtual events, isn't it?
Yeah, no borders.
Yeah.
It's much easier to organize. No pizzas and things to show up.
Yeah. But it's easier as well getting people like Barry and others to do the tools. Yeah.
We are lunch entertainment. Well, I hope it's entertaining. I'll do my best.
It is. I saw the same talk recently, and you're going to repeat it for my user group.
Yes.
Thank you.
This is already a slightly evolved version. Every time I do it, it evolves a little bit.
I like that.
Apologies if there was any introduction and I missed it. I had problems with audio, just connected.
Yeah, usually I wait till 5 past, but seeing as it's going to be recorded, Barry, if I, so it's being recorded now. Are you ready to get kick started in a minute?
Sure.
Cool. So obviously I'll let the room fill up. I think this is this is the first event of 2021. It's going to be hopefully a better year than the one we've just had. It definitely will be for this group. We've got, obviously we're lucky to have Barry speaking today. We've also got 3 more events booked up from now until the end of Feb. The idea from now on will be doing these fortnightly. We've got quite a lot of interesting speakers, but really happy to have Barry come in for the first one of 2021. For those who don't know Barry, you can find him in all socials at Azure Barry or Azure Barry if you're not from the Netherlands. Barry, not only being a contractor or a freelancer himself, you can catch him speaking weekly on the Developer Podcast, where he invites quite reputable names in the world of development. I think you had Scott Hanselman on recently, didn't you?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
and you've already done quite a few things with him. That's one of the first things that comes up when you search Barry on YouTube is the talks you've done on Azure with Scott. In the session, he'll be able to give a bit more of an in-depth description than me, but he'll be breaking down all the services in Azure, which are meant for developers. I'm going to hand over the hosting control to Barry and going to let him do the rest. So cheers.
All right. Let me share my screen here. Can I have control, please, of the thing?
Yes, sorry, one moment.
Yeah. It's always fun with the online meetings. It's part of how it works. Huh?
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. All right, let's see. There we go. All right, you should be able to see my screen, right?
Yep.
Excellent, okay. So, well, thank you very much for having me, first of all. It's always very nice to be invited to talk at any event, especially virtual events. I like those a lot. So, yeah. Hi, I'm Barry. I usually don't pronounce my last name. It's Luybrecht in Dutch, but it's a difficult thing in English. So I usually keep it to Hi, I'm Barry. You can find me at Azure Barry on Twitter and at my website as well. If you think, hey, what's the weird background of this guy? This is actually a sound booth I'm in, and that's why it doesn't echo anymore. I'm so happy with it. It's very warm in here, though, but I have fun. So today we will talk about Microsoft Azure and then which services to use for which scenarios. Like Luke also said, I host a weekly podcast called the Developer Weekly Podcast. You can find that in your favorite podcast player or at developerweeklypodcast.com. And there I talked to people like Scott Hanselman, Matt Storgerson about C#. You name it. This week, I have Dale Meredith on about the ethical hacking, which was a fun one. And every week there's a new one. And obviously it's for free, so check that out. You can also find me on Pluralsight. I create Pluralsight courses about Azure, of course. I recently released a couple about the Azure AZ-304 exam for architects. But I have lots more also about HTML and CI/CD, all sorts of stuff. And today's talk is kind of based on the course Microsoft Azure for Developers, What to Use When. So in this talk today, I'm going to cover a couple of categories, as in what to use for running an application and what to use for hosting data, for instance, and a couple others. But in this course, there are more categories, so you can always go to Pluralsight and see more in more detail. Now, why this topic? Because Microsoft Azure is huge, and you know this probably, and that's probably because you are why you are at this talk. Because there are so many services, you know, and they keep on coming. Every Ignite or Microsoft Build, there's another service or more features of a service. And it's kind of confusing, right? Because some services seem to do the same thing and others are completely different and there's overlap here or there. So, you know, what to use when? That is a big question. That's always a big question in Azure because it's kind of overwhelming. So I try to help with that, with this course or with the course and also with this talk. So let's start by going through two of the categories, and that is what to use when running your application in Azure and what to use when storing your data in Azure. And after that, we have a couple more categories. Now, if you have any questions in the meantime, just save them up, please, because in the end, I will have some time specifically for questions, because if we do that during the talk itself, you know, we'll get stuck and the whole flow is gone. So please wait, hold your questions until the end. There will be plenty of time and I can always stay a little bit later as well. So let's see, what to use when for running your applications in Azure? When I think of this question, I first think of, well, which questions do I need to ask to discover which services to use when? And those are these three main big picture questions. And that's how much control do I need over the service? And we're going to go into these questions in a bit. Where do I need my application to run? Is it on Azure, also on premises, or both, or maybe on AWS as well? And what usage model do I need? Just a second, let me just close a panel here. As in, does my app have to run all the time, 24/7, or is it less or different or something else? And once I've answered these questions, I can then filter down the services that I can choose from and then look at the actual functionality of those services. Now, in this talk and also in the course, I only go to the level of the functionality, that as deep. But really, if you're picking a service for, let's say, running your application in Azure, obviously you also should take a look at, well, what are the availability requirements that I need? What is the performance requirement that I need? What is the cost that I'm looking at? And you need to do all that stuff. But that is so much in detail. And for instance, the cost aspect that changes so much and so often, and it is so dependent on your very, very specific situation, that is very difficult to create generic advice for. So therefore, I keep it to functionality. So let's go to the first question. How much control do I need? Now, if you think about this question, it's all between control and responsibility and working on business value. So for instance, if you have services that fall into the infrastructure as a service category, so on the left there, you have services like virtual machines, containers as well. In that category, you have a lot of control over your services. So you have control over the network, over antivirus, operating system, so you can install stuff, custom things on your operating system, over your server configuration. So do you run 64-bit, 32-bit, how much memory do you have, things like that. The application itself, obviously, you have control over, and also the application configuration. So for instance, connection strings, feature flags, things like that. But because you have control over all those things, also means that you are responsible for all of those things. So in a virtual machine, you are responsible for the operating system. Now you can let Azure do a little bit for you, but still ultimately you are responsible. Same goes for a container. If there is an update or security update for that container image, it's up to you to actually create a new version of your container image, roll that and actually deploy that. It's your responsibility. So you are responsible for all that stuff and keeping everything safe. But in return, you get control over that. Now, if you need a bit less control, you can go to platform as a service. Those are things like Azure App Service, SQL Azure Database, for instance, where Azure does a little bit more for you. So you don't have control over the operating system anymore, but you do have control over the server configuration. So how much memory do you have? How much cores? Is it 64-bit, 32-bit, HTTP2 or not? Things like that. You obviously have control over your application because you make that and you deploy that to your, let's say, Azure App Service. And also you have control over your application configuration. So your feature flags and your connection strings and things. Now, more up the stack, you go to what I like to call logic as a service, also called serverless. These are things like Azure Functions and also logic apps, for instance. And in this case, you kind of only have control over the application. So with an Azure function, really, you just deploy the Azure function to the cloud and the cloud scales for you there. It does that automatically for you. A logic app, the same thing. You just configure your application basically, and then it just works and you have no idea where it runs on. It runs somewhere on the server, of course, but that's not your responsibility anymore. But it also means that you do not have control over it anymore, which can or cannot be a bad thing, depending on your needs, of course. And then way up the stack, you have software as a service, and there you let everything go. Azure does most of the things, including actually provide the software for you. So these are things like the cognitive services, for instance. Those are applications, APIs that run in the cloud, and all you can do is just call them, just use them. You just consume those things. What you can do there is configure them a little bit. Let's say you use the bot framework or the Azure Health Bot, which is a new thing, for instance. That is a bot that is as a service there, and you can just configure it to kind of do what you want, but Azure just runs the whole thing, including the application, so you don't actually deploy a new version of the application. So when you think about how much control do I actually need, you need to start thinking about how much control do you need over all these individual parts, and how much responsibility are you willing to take for that? Because that also means that you need to train up your team, free up resources to do all this stuff and to take care of, let's say, your operating system. So that's the first question. And then the second question is, where do I need my application to run? Now that can be in Azure, of course, but in Azure, there's also nuances. You have the Azure Public Cloud, there's Azure Government Cloud, and there's Azure Stack as well, or somewhere else, for instance, and or somewhere else. Somewhere else could be on premises, on your local cloud, or on your server under your desk, for instance, or local development computer, or in other clouds as well. It's not uncommon that you want your application to run in Azure and also in, let's say, AWS, or parts of it also in AWS. Now, the third question is, what usage model do I need? And this is all about, how will my application be used? That can be all the time. Let's say you have an e-commerce application like Amazon.com, where people go and buy stuff. Maybe they use that from all over the world, then you need to have that on all the time, 24/7, really. So that is what I call then the classic model. It is always on. So 24/7, this thing needs to be able to run. And that also means that you have services where you pay per month. So things like an app service, for instance, that's on all the time. Or your app might be used occasionally. Maybe it's an API, for instance, that's called once a day, twice a day, or 100 times a day, who knows. In that case, you have the serverless model, so logic as a service. This only runs when it's needed, let's say an API. It only runs when an API is called there, and you pay typically per execution and a little bit for the storage where this thing is configured and runs. But your main pay there is per execution and not the whole month for having the thing on. So this is then the third question. How will your application be used? Once you've answered these three questions, then you can take a look at what functionality do I need. All right. So let's just take a look at an example for these three questions. So the first one is, I trust Azure to scale for me. So this could be platform as a service. My application needs to run in Azure and also on premises. And my application only needs to run once every hour. So the serverless model here. Now, how do you then go about picking your service? Because these are all the services that you can use for running your application in Azure. And I'm actually still missing one that I need to put in there, which I'll tell you in a second. You have virtual machines, so actual virtual machines. You have container instances, which you can use to run a single container, and you don't per se need an orchestrator. You have Azure Kubernetes service, which you can use to run multiple containers in a with the Kubernetes orchestrator. There's Azure Web Apps for containers, which is also for single containers. And then you use web app features, Azure App Service web app features like deployment slots. There's Azure Batch, and you use Azure Batch to run scaled out batch jobs. Let's say a job where you render a movie file or a huge Pixar movie. Let's say you chuck that job up into multiple smaller pieces, and Batch can scale that out for you. And once it is done, it scales it all back. There's also Azure Service Fabric, which is the service that many other services run on, like for instance, Azure SQL Database runs on Azure Service Fabric under the covers within Microsoft data centers. And you can use that to basically run any application really. And there's also Azure App Service Fabric, Azure Service Fabric Mesh. See how confusing this is? The mesh feature is then the serverless version of Service Fabric. There's also Azure Cloud Services. This is one of the oldest services that's in the cloud. And those are really old school. You can run web applications in there and also background applications. Please don't use those anymore if you're starting a new project, because they will stay there. Microsoft's not going to deprecate them anytime soon because people are relying on them. But they are not advising you to use them still, because what you would use instead is then Azure App Services. So Azure App Services web app, which you use to run a web application, a mobile app to use to run an API for mobile apps, and Azure Functions to use small pieces of code as part of a process, and then Azure Logic Apps that you can use to run and orchestrate a complete process, so multiple steps of a process. So those are a lot of services, and there's also Azure Java Cloud. I'm spacing on the name. There's a service also for Java applications, a managed service that you can use to run Java applications in the cloud. So there's something for everybody. Now, if you divvy those up into the categories of control and responsibility, then these services fall into the infrastructure as a service domain. So those are virtual machines, the container services, so container instances, Kubernetes service, web apps for containers, also Azure Batch, because Azure Batch runs on virtual machines or on containers, and also a little bit Azure Service Fabric, because you also can use Azure Service Fabric as a container orchestrator and then run containers on there. You can do it. And then there's also platform as a service, and these are then the services that fall into that category, which is then the cloud services, the old school cloud services, and the Azure App Services. So Azure App Services web apps and Azure App Services mobile apps, but also a little bit Azure Service Fabric, because besides being able to use it as a container orchestrator and running containers in it, you can also use it to just run services on, as in you can package a service in a special Service Fabric SDK package and just run it there as a service. And then Service Fabric make sure there's multiple instances of that service running, make sure they're all available, that you can update them, all that stuff, and just runs them there, stateless and stateful. Pretty cool, actually. And then there are the logic as a service services, so serverless services, and those are Azure Functions for a small part of a process, and then Azure Logic Apps for the complete process. And therefore, the infrastructure as a service, so VMs and containers, are for control and responsibility when you need a lot of control and also are responsible for things like operating system, where the logic as a service has the least responsibility but also the least control. Now, if you want to stay vendor agnostic, so run anywhere, then these are kind of the services that you can choose there. So VM you can kind of use anywhere, because you could use a virtual machine image on Azure, but you can also use the same virtual machine image itself, the VHD file, on, let's say, AWS or on-premises. Containers, obviously, you can use those anywhere, including on-premises, and also Azure Service Fabric, because the Service Fabric SDK, you can install that anywhere, even on your local machine, on-premises, or in another cloud, which is pretty cool. And also Azure Functions as well, because Azure Functions can run in the Azure Functions runtime, and that runtime can be installed anywhere, even in a container. Azure Logic Apps, the same thing, can run on the Azure Functions runtime and therefore can run basically anywhere as well. So if you want to stay vendor agnostic and run your application anywhere, it's not really vendor agnostic, but at least you can run your application anywhere, you could use these services for that. Now, if you want to run your application only occasionally, so serverless, then these guys are for you. So Azure Functions, Azure Logic Apps, but also kind of Azure Batch, because Azure Batch is not something that runs all the time. It is something that runs your batch job. So your job of smaller jobs and scales that out. And once it's done, it actually goes back in and scales down all of those nodes that are doing the work. So it's also kind of a serverless service. Now, let's compare the functionality of all these things. And because there are so many services, I chuck them up into a couple of categories. So I start by comparing container options and virtual machines. So we have the VM, we have container instances, Kubernetes service, AKS, web apps for containers, batch, service fabric. I kind of feel like an auctioneer talking so fast about all of these crazy services because there are so many. So if you want to lift and shift your application to the cloud, so you don't really want to change it, but you do want to get into the cloud, and then from there you'll see whatever you can optimize, then a virtual machine is great for you because you might be running that thing in a virtual machine already anyways, and you can relatively easily port that to the cloud. If you want to run a simple application within a container and you don't really want to deal with a container orchestrator, you could also use a virtual machine, like simple application, or also container instances. If you want a more complex application with an orchestrator, like Kubernetes service, for instance, then Kubernetes service is for you. So you want to have multiple services, multiple containers, one that runs your API, another one, maybe also an API, another one, the UI, let's say, then Kubernetes service is what you want. Or Service Fabric, because Service Fabric has its own container orchestrator. So you can also run containers in there with a complex solution. If you want to run orchestrated microservices, then you can do that in Azure Service Fabric. That is really promoted as a microservice run service. And you can do that then in containers or on the Azure Service Fabric platform itself. You can also do that in Kubernetes service if you want, because obviously you can orchestrate containers in there as well. Well, I'm not a big fan of actually doing that because, jiminy Christmas, that is really a complex service still. And it's also very much moving within functionality, and they introduce breaking functionality a lot. But you know, you could do it. If you want to run your application anywhere, which means on-premises or in other clouds as well, then Azure Service Fabric is your thing because you can install the Service Fabric SDK anywhere. And if you want to run a web app on Windows or Linux with app service features like deployment slots and easy authentication and authorization, then you can use Azure Web App for Containers. And finally, if you have repetitive jobs that run on massive scale, like I said, for instance, the rendering of a large movie file, then you could do that with Azure Batch. All right. So where do you run your background tasks? Well, you could use Azure Cloud Services, Web Jobs, Functions, Batch, and that's it. So if you want short running tasks, well, you can use them all because all of them can do short running tasks. And in Cloud Services, that would also be the background worker role that you would use. If you want to run a long running task, well, actually you can use them all as well, including Azure Functions, which you can use durable functions, for instance, but you can also scale up normal Azure Functions to run a little bit longer as well. Depends on what's long, of course. And additionally, you can also run an Azure function on top of an Azure App Services plan, as in not serverless, not in a serverless mode. And then you can run your functions however long you want, for a day or longer. If you have very resource intensive tasks, then you should use Azure Batch because that can really scale out with VMs underneath or containers and then scale back in when the thing is done. If you want a service where you pay all month for running it, then Azure Cloud Services is your thing. That's really an old school service that just runs a VM basically with a little layer of abstraction on it, and it runs all month. Web Jobs is the same. Web Jobs is basically a companion for Azure App Services, and it was the it came before Azure Functions, spacing on the word there. Azure Functions is the evolution of Azure Web Jobs, and Web Jobs then doesn't run serverless, so you pay for it all month. If you only want to pay for when you run the thing, then you use an Azure Function, or also use a Azure Batch as well, because Azure Batch can also do serverless, missing a dot there. If you need to deploy a complete application to run your thing, which means that you have to create a lot of plumbing around your code in order to actually run the thing in your cloud service or in your service, and cloud service is your thing because you need a complete template to run it in there. And Azure Batch is the same as well, because you need to fill out a whole template to tell it what to do, which kind of makes sense. Azure Functions and Web Jobs are a bit easier. They need a little bit of instructions, but basically it's just the code that you want to run, and you you just put it there. So only the code that's necessary to run within the thing. So those are background tasks. Now, where to run your applications? We're comparing web apps, mobile apps, cloud services, service fabric, functions, and logic apps as well. If you want to host a web application, well, then you go for Azure App Services web app, and also cloud services, because they can also host the web worker role. And also Service Fabric, because they can basically run anything. If you want to host your own APIs, then also a web app, because you use a web app for any web application, any HTTP-based web application, including APIs. And also cloud services, because also a web-facing thing. And also Service Fabric, because it basically can run anything. But also Azure Functions, because you could use an Azure Function as an HTTP-triggered thing, and then it can just process whatever your API does, and then just return a request. If you want to host a backend for mobile applications, then you would use Azure App Services mobile apps, and it has features that support that scenario, like offline sync, for instance, and push notifications. If you want to automate one step of a larger process, then Azure Functions is your thing. You put the code in there for basically one step. For instance, you get an image. Whenever an image goes into blob storage, Azure Function triggers, it resizes the image and puts it back there. One step of the process. If you want to automate a complete process, then you would use Azure Logic Apps. So a Logic App could, for instance, call a bunch of Azure Functions or other APIs then to follow steps within the process. If you want to enjoy features like deployment slots and easy authentication, authorization, and others, then you would use services in the Azure App Services family. So Azure App Services Web App, Azure App Services Mobile App, and Azure Functions, which is also part of Azure App Services under the hood. And also cloud services, kind of, because they also do deployment slots. If you want to run microservices at massive scale, then you could use Azure Service Fabric. Like before I said, it is designed to run microservices loads, either in containers or on the Service Fabric platform itself with its own SDK. And you could also do it with Azure Functions, because you can run APIs in Azure Functions. So technically you could run microservices at massive scale. Don't know if it's a good idea. I've seen people do it. It's up to you. So that's running your application in Azure. Now, that was a big one. The other categories are a little bit smaller, so don't worry. The next one is storing your data in Azure. So these are the questions that I would ask, the big picture questions. What will I use the data for? And what type of data am I going to store there? And after I've answered those, I can take a look at the functionality that I specifically need for my application. So what will I use the data for? Is that for your applications, for your forms over data applications? You know, a user goes there, puts in some data, and you know, you return something or you store that data. Those kind of applications are very common, obviously, and are called OLTP, or online transactional processing applications. Or are you going to use your data for data analytics, for instance, for analyzing the data later, or do some machine learning on there? Then you would, that usage type is called OLAP, or online analytical processing. Totally different types, and there are different data stores that support these different types of data. What type of data am I going to store? Because there's different types of data. Are you going to store? Good. Yeah, thank you. Are you going to store relational data, so tables with rows and columns, Or are you going to store other types of data, unstructured data, which could be things like document data or key value data or graph data or other stuff, audio files, document data. So this is an example of these questions. So my application is an online reservation system. So that means an OLTP application, a form over data application. And my application needs to store and retrieve document data. All right, let's take a look. These are the options for storing data in Azure. That's a lot still. We can do it faster than running your application in Azure. So we have Azure SQL Database, which is basically Azure SQL Server in the cloud. This thing comes in many forms, in a managed form, in a serverless form nowadays, and also in a more rigid form that you could use as kind of an infrastructure as a service offering. But it's a fun service and a staple of mine. There's also Azure databases for MySQL, Azure databases for PostgreSQL, Azure databases for MariaDB. These are basically the managed equivalents of these databases. So for instance, if you're running a MySQL database right now, you could relatively easily migrate that thing over to the cloud, and then you can benefit of having Azure run that instead of you running it yourself. There's also Azure Cosmos DB, and that is a document database. That's a very interesting one, because data that's stored in there, you can talk to in multiple APIs. So for instance, you could use the MongoDB API to talk to that. You could use a SQL API to talk to that, or a Graph API to talk to that. And on top of that, it's also geo-replicated with multiple active nodes there. So it's a very cool service. Then there's also Azure Storage. And there's Azure File Storage, Azure Queue Storage, Azure Blob Storage, Azure Table Storage, and Azure Disk Storage. File storage, obviously, is where you store files. That's basically a hard disk that you can mount. There's Azure Queue Storage, which is a queuing mechanism. It's also a storage mechanism, but for very small files that you then put in a queue. There's Azure Blob Storage, which are documents that you put in there, real-life blobs. Blobs of an audio file, let's say, that you put in there. And there's Azure Table Storage, which is kind of relational, but not really. It is a table with rows and columns, but then each row can have different columns. So that's a bit different there. And there's also no relationship between the data. So it's not really relational. And then there's also Azure Storage Disk Storage, and that you would use, that's also files, of course, but you would use that specifically to mount in virtual machines. And then in the bottom there, we see Azure Synapse Analytics and also Azure Data Lake Store. Azure Synapse Analytics was Azure SQL Data Warehouse, and they've now renamed that to Azure Synapse Analytics and also added a couple of features there. Azure Data Lake Store is the big data store where you can just put whatever in there and you can analyze that later. We'll go into what these can do in a bit. So if you're want an application for online transactional processing, so forms over data, you can choose from the above data source. So Azure SQL Database, all the Azure database for MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, also Cosmos DB, and Azure Storage. But if you're looking for an online analytical processing thing, so big data that you store for machine learning or other analytical things, reporting, then you would use Azure Synapse Analytics or Azure Data Lake Store. Now, if you look at what type of data then could you use, relational data is Azure SQL Database for MySQL, PostgreSQL, and MariaDB. These are all things with tables with rows and columns. If you look at unstructured and document data, like I said, Cosmos DB is a document data database. And Azure Storage also does the same with all these different services. And like I also explained, Azure Table Storage is not really relational, so kind of also a document store or a semi-structured data store as an in-between. And then there is data analytics. And also between these are also relational and unstructured document data, and we'll see that in a bit. Now, let's take a look at the functionality of these things, and we'll compare first the OLTP services. So those are Azure SQL Database, MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, Cosmos DB, and all the Azure Storage services. I kind of put them all together, basically because otherwise the slide is too small because there's too many services. And also they kind of do the same thing there. So if you want to store relational data, then all of these work and not Cosmos DB or Azure Storage, like we just said. If you want to store semi or non-relational data, then these two guys work, so CosmosDB and Azure Storage. If you want to use Microsoft tools to manage your storage, then you could use Azure SQL Database, because obviously it's SQL Server. You could use SQL Server Management Studio or the Data Explorer. Data Studio it's called. And CosmosDB is kind of the same thing there as well. You could use Data Studio for that as well, and Azure Storage as well. Now, the other services, so MySQL, PostgreSQL, and MariaDB, they kind of have their own ecosystem of tools and other tooling. So if you're already using a MySQL or PostgreSQL or MariaDB, then you are comfortable with those tools, and then you can use those exact same tools also with these managed versions in the cloud. Now, if you want to use a service with advanced querying capabilities, then you could use Azure SQL Database because it's SQL Server. Also MySQL, PostgreSQL, MariaDB, and also CosmosDB as well, because you can use lots of different APIs, and they have all sorts of advanced querying capabilities, but not so much Azure Storage, because it's much simpler. You would use OData queries to get to the data there. So you could basically filter through your data, but you couldn't really create very complex queries when you want it to be performant. So if you want to use multiple APIs to access the same data, like I said, that's in CosmosDB, where you could use the MongoDB API, SQLDB, Graph, QL API, which is very cool. Just a sec. Yeah. So let's take a look at the online analytical processing ones. So we have Azure Synapse Analytics and Azure Data Lake Store. So if you want to store relational data, then you had to do that in Azure Synapse Analytics, because that's basically Azure SQL Data Warehouse. And that is also made up out of tables with rows and columns. Azure Data Lake Store, you can do that as well, because basically you can store anything in Azure Data Lake Store. If you want to store non-relational data, you cannot do that in Azure Synapse Data Analytics, because it requires tables with rows and columns. But you can do that in Azure Data Lake Store, because you can basically store whatever you want in there and then sort it out later. This service, Azure Synapse Analytics, this one requires you to create a schema before you start putting stuff in, because obviously you need tables with rows and columns. So you need to think about how you're going to form that. Are you going to design it before you start putting data in there? And this one, Azure Data Lake Store, has basically no data or file size limits. And Azure Synapse Analytics is getting there as well. But Azure Data Lake Store is there for a long time already. And the real limit there is basically your credit card, obviously, because, you know, once you start using more, you just pay more. And so this one, Azure Synapse Analytics, when do you use that? You use that when you know which answers that you want the data to, which questions you want the data to answer, because you need to design the whole schema up front. So with your questions in mind, you can then design your schema up front to answer those questions. And that's not the case for Azure Data Lake Store. You would use Azure Data Lake Store if you don't yet know what kind of questions that you want the data to answer. So maybe you want to do some machine analytics on there, machine learning on there, to see what comes up, you know, see if there's any patterns in there you don't know yet. All right, next category, how to choose Azure services to speed up your application. Now, these are the options for speeding up your apps in Azure. That is Azure Content Delivery Network. That is Azure Cache for Redis, which is a key value pair cache. There's Azure Traffic Manager, and there's Azure Front Door. Azure Traffic Manager is a global DNS-based load balancer. And Azure Front Door is also a global load balancer, but it is HTTP-based. I'll see that in a bit. So here are the questions that I would ask. Are my users globally distributed? Does my application use data that is used a lot but does not change often? And does my app use audio, video, or images? And then afterwards, I would take a look at the functionality. Now, are my users globally distributed? If that's not the case, then okay. If that is the case, then I would choose, is my traffic between users and app HTTP based or not? If that is the case, then I would use Azure Front Door, because it is a global load balancer and it is HTTP based. So it can have multiple endpoints, let's say Azure App Services web apps all over the world, that would then be behind an Azure front door, or it would route your traffic to those app services if it is HTTP based. If that is not the case, if it is DNS based, if it is TCP based, for instance, then you would use Azure Traffic Manager for that. And then on top of that, you could use the other services to also speed your application up. So Azure Content Delivery Network, see in a bit what that does, and also Azure Redis Cache. Now, is my data used often and changes little? So if you have this data, for instance, an order table, these are all orders in there, this data changes often and it is also used a lot. So there's new orders coming in, orders are deleted, orders are updated all the time. This changes a lot. But this data here is also used a lot within, let's say, a form that I've that users fill out with the countries, but it changes little. So it's used a lot, but it changes little. So this type of data, a table with country codes in it, that would be perfect to put into an Azure cache for Redis. And that's kind of what it sounds like. It is a cache. And what does that do? It provides in-memory data for optimal speed. Now, why is that faster than, for instance, storing this in SQL Server? Well, in Azure SQL Database, you could also theoretically store this in an in-memory table, which would also be very fast. But you would also have to always have to perform a query to get your data, where in an Azure cache for Redis, this is all stored in key value pairs. So these countries, for instance, would just be stored with a key there. So you would just retrieve them with a key without performing a complete query and having the service create a query plan and all that stuff and executing it. You just retrieve it there. So therefore it's much faster than putting it into a database. Now, this also has advanced features like geo-replication, which means that the data that is in the cache can replicate to other geographical regions, and also data persistence. For instance, if Amazon would use this, and that would be, shopping cart data in there, maybe in a couple of minutes, there would be a couple of $1 million worth of shopping cart data. If they were to lose that, that would be very expensive for them potentially. So you could also then persist the data onto disk, let's say, the data that is in Azure Cache for Redis, and then have it be spun up later if the service goes down or if you need to reboot it. So then last question, does my application use audio, video, or images? Well, if that is the case, like for instance, for this website, you might have some static files here, some audio files, video files, or other static files like JavaScript files. If that's the case and your users are close by, then that's all fine. But if your users are further away, that becomes a problem. Now, why is that? Because of latency. Every time you make a request to get this audio file, let's say from your website to download that, it takes a little bit of time. It takes a little bit of latency, and latency is the time that it takes for the signal to travel across the wire and across the hops. Now, yes, this is at the speed of light, but the speed of light needs to go through this whole wire under the ocean, and maybe does a hop through a couple of routers there. Maybe it goes to a satellite here or there, and that takes time. So when it's further away, it might take, let's say 173 milliseconds, which is not a lot, right? But still, latency adds up. So if you have a website and you have, let's say, 10 requests on that website, and every request is 173 milliseconds, then that is 1.7 seconds of latency. So that's on top of the loading time and all that other stuff that you need to do, rendering it in your browser. And that can become really, really slow. So what do we do? How do we solve this? Well, we can put our static files, so audio files, CSS and JavaScript files, in a content delivery network point of presence, or POP. Now, if we do that, these POPs are all over the world. So a content delivery network will replicate those to all over the world, which means that it will always be close somewhere to a user, which means that if you then do that, you kind of eliminate the large latencies. Now, in Azure, that works with Azure CDN. Azure CDN, what you do is you create an Azure CDN endpoint, and then you have something like Azure Blob Storage or another storage mechanism You put your static files in there, and then you couple that to Azure CDN. And once it is coupled, Azure CDN starts replicating that data, that static data, to all its points of presence all over the world. And there are a lot more points of presence over the world than there are Azure data centers. So there will always be one that is close to your user. And then what do you do in your website? When you point to that static file, to that image or whatever, you just change the URL from being in your website to being in Azure CDN. So for instance, website.azureedge.net/cookie.jpg. It's that simple. Now, let's take a look at the functionality between these things. If you want to offload traffic from your application, what can you do? You can use these three services. So Azure CDN, because not only does that populate and put your data close to the user, but also because it is in a CDN and no longer on your website, the CDN processes that image and spends CPU cycles rendering that image and sending it to you, and your website doesn't have to do that anymore. Redis cache, obviously, because that then processes the data and your website or your application doesn't have to do that anymore. And also Azure Front Door, because Azure Front Door also contains a CDN in there as well. So you could also use that as CDN instead of Azure CDN. If you want to bring your data closer to your users, then you could use these three services. Again, also Azure Redis Cache, because you can do geo-replication within Azure Redis Cache. If you want to bring your application closer to your users, you could use Azure Traffic Manager, because you can then route your traffic globally to the most performant application, and also Azure Front Door, because it also does global load balancing, just like Azure Traffic Manager. And if you want to provide fast in-memory access to data, then you would have Azure Redis Cache. All right, final category. And after that, there will be some time for questions. How to choose Azure services to monitor your application? Well, these are the options that you have to monitor applications in Azure. That's Azure Application Insights. You would use this to monitor a single application, usually a single web application or API, but you could also use it for monitoring desktop applications, although it's not marketed as such. Azure Visual Studio App Center, it's actually called. You could use this to deploy, test, and also monitor your mobile applications. And then there's also Azure Network Watcher that you can use to diagnose network problems, like what's the next hop, for instance. Azure Monitor, which is the overall service that actually contains features like Application Insights and Network Watcher, because Application Insights is now a feature of Azure Monitor. And Security Center as well. I'll go into what that is as well. Azure Advisor, where you can see recommendations of costs, speed, performance, security of all your applications, and from there you can actually implement them as well. And Azure Sentinel, and we're going to see what that does in a second. So here are the questions that I would ask. What is the scope that I need to monitor? So is that only an application, so one application? Then I would use Application Insights, for instance, or App Center for mobile apps. Or is it on a subscription level, let's say, or a resource group level where I need to monitor multiple applications? Then you would use these other services like Azure Monitor, for instance. Now, let me drill into a couple of these services. Azure Application Insights, one of my favorite services here. You would use that to monitor a single web or desktop application in detail. It monitors and alerts on many things. It's basically like Google Analytics, but then the Azure variant, and I think it's much better. So it can monitor availability, performance, failures, usage as well, how many people come to my website. And you can have it do pings and multi-step web tests as well, where you say, well, ping my website every 5 minutes from these five locations and let me know if it's not available. It can send its data to a log analytics workspace, which is basically a bucket where you can store data, and as you monitor then looks at that data and uses a log analytics workspace to query that data. You can also continuously export raw data of this thing in JSON format to, let's say, your Azure storage. And it also has an application map, which is a very useful feature. So when you click on that, you see, well, this is my website, and here is the SQL database that is connected to it. This is Azure storage, and it had three failures to Azure SQL, and the performance to Azure Storage is poor or is good, for instance. It's great for diagnosing. Now, the other one is Azure Monitor, which is a very important one. Let's see how that works. There's many sources of log data in the world of Azure. We have Azure resources that produce data. There's obviously applications that have lots of log files and other data that they produce. There's virtual machine agents, and there's data collector APIs as well. And all that data comes into a log analytics workspace, or it comes into a Azure Monitor Metrics workspace. And those are time series data stores. And these two data stores are then coupled to Azure Monitor. And Azure Monitor can use that to, with log analytics, what was called log analytics, and the Metrics Explorer, to query all that data and to make sense of it. So it can make reports out of it in the form of workbooks and insights. It can alert on all that data, and you can create dashboards of all of that data. So with Azure Monitor, you can create, let's say, a dashboard of all of your production resources and see how they are doing. It's an overall monitoring service. Now, also Azure Security Center versus Azure Sentinel. I always want to explain this. These are the steps within the security process of any organization. You have collect and prevent when there is an incident. So you want visibility of an incident. You want to prevent an incident. So visibility of weaknesses within your systems. You need to detect an incident with analytics and also by actively hunting it. When there is an incident, you want to investigate it. So what is it? Why did it happen? What is it doing? And then you also want to respond. Maybe you want to stop things, or you want to alert people with that. Azure Security Center does this for you. It brings visibility and prevention. So it can analyze your services and tell you, well, these are the security holes in those services, and this is how you can fix them. And then it can also detect and analyze a little bit of incidents, but it's not super good at it. And Azure Sentinel can do it all. So when would you use Azure Sentinel or Security Center? Well, Security Center you would use primarily for prevention purposes. So you'd open that up, and then you would see, all right, these are the practical steps that I can take to actually make everything more secure. Where Azure Sentinel can also do that, but doesn't provide you with those practical steps there, but does the rest a lot better, the hunting, the incidents, the automation, and also the analytics there. Now, let's compare the features of these monitoring services. This is relatively straightforward, actually. So if you want to monitor a web or desktop application, you would use Application Insights. If you want to monitor a mobile application, you would use App Center, Visual Studio App Center. If you want to investigate and respond to security issues, then you would use Azure Sentinel, like we just saw. And if you want to inspect network traffic to diagnose problems, then you would use Azure Network Watcher. If you want to get an overview of all monitoring data, like we just saw, you would use Azure Monitor that then uses an Azure Log Analytics workspace and also the time series workspace for metrics to query all that data and to create dashboards of it. And if you want to monitor and prevent security issues, so more prevention there, you would use Security Center. And then finally, if you want to get an overview of all actionable recommendations, so also for performance and cost, then you would use Azure Advisor. All right. So these are the last couple of slides. How do you stay up to date with Azure? This is what I do. I use the Azure Architecture Center, which is great. Has example solution architectures in there and best practices. I use Azure Friday as well. That's a weekly thing from Scott Hanselman, where he does videos from mostly the actual product teams of Azure, where they explain a feature or a new service within Azure within a couple minutes. There's also a couple of blogs that I follow, and you'll see the URLs in the next slide. And obviously you can take Pluralsight courses as well. So these are the URLs for that stuff. And here's a thing that I did not mention, which is Azure Tips and Tricks, which are blogs and videos that I also create for Microsoft sometimes. And you can find it at microsoft.github.io/Azure Tips and Tricks. And those videos are pretty cool because they're usually 3-4 minutes where I then explain some Azure service or a feature of an Azure service. I will make sure that Luke gets these slides as well, and it's being recorded as well, so that you don't have to copy all of this from the screen if you want to
Obviously, find me on Plural site and check out my podcast as well. All right. So I hope you guys enjoyed that. And if you have any questions, let me know.
Yeah, thanks, Barry. Yeah, I think all the questions have kind of been answered over, well, the session. And people were asking about how they catch you, like where your website was. That's been answered. That's, of course, azurebarry.com. And obviously the developerweeklypodcast.com. Yeah, they're saying, please, can you upload this material into a Plural site channel? Here we go. Here's a question from David. Perhaps the only points he can contribute, consider which services could also be hosted on-prem in, say, Azure Stack Hub, so app service functions, or Azure Stack HCI VMs in terms of hybrid approaches. Take into account the pricing models available for some services, e.g. consumption plans for functions, API management, which can really reduce cost whilst providing good scalability. Combined with Event Grid, he's had a lot of success with that approach, especially with startups where you might not have the budget, but often need to suddenly scale. So not so much a question, more so a bit of a statement there. Here's one from Umesh. What are Azure's offerings for GPU intensive applications?
Well, then you would look more at the, currently at VMs. There are special VMs there that have very large GPU things. They're also very expensive, but that would be the place where you would look at VMs.
Okay, cheers. Anyone else? Nope, just a lot of thankful people. Oh, here we go. Here's a few. Is there a reporting service for AKS that can report on the lifetime of a container, aka cost, runtime, etc.?
Not in Azure at the moment. There might be some. There might be open source ones, as Kubernetes is being used a lot, not only in Azure, but also, let's say, in Google Cloud and in AWS. So it could be that somebody wrote something for that, but there's not a managed Azure service for that at the moment. And also monitoring for AKS is kind of just starting up within Azure as well. And then I see another one, which is, if I want to host a REST API for an app, including notifications, and use it also for a web application.
Yeah, if I can break in, I want to host a web API, and I want to use it, share it between an app and for example, a Blazor application. What would you recommend, a web or an app service?
There would be an Azure App Service web app, which that would be the go-to thing for hosting APIs. Now, there used to be an Azure App Services API app, but that doesn't exist anymore because that basically did the same thing as Azure App Services web apps. So you would use an Azure App Services web app for that. Yeah.
And do you also have then the notification support? Or?
Oh, right. You need notification. What kind of notifications would you need where?
In the app.
In the app itself.
Yeah. Yeah, and XAML Forms app.
Oh, okay, an actual mobile app.
Yeah. A mobile app, but I want to share the API with a Blazor application.
Oh, right.
Because I don't want to write two REST APIs. It shares functionality.
If you really want a mobile application, like a proper native mobile app notification, I mean, then you would use Azure App Services mobile apps, because that has the functionality of native mobile notifications. But if you also want notifications in your Blazor application, that's a bit different, and you cannot get a native thing there, of course. So you would then probably use something like Azure Signal R Hub, Signal R service. And then, if you do that, you could get notified, but then you would have to implement your own notification logic there.
You're talking about push notifications on the phone combined with browser pop-ups?
I guess, right?
Yeah, you would something also, like that, yeah.
I'm only aware of Firebase, but that's not Azure. that does integrate it.
No, no. But that would be this. Yeah, that does the same thing, kind of like push notifications in Azure with Azure mobile apps. Yeah.
Maybe Flutter. Like, I didn't look into Flutter in detail, but apparently it's one platform to develop all three platforms: AIOS, Android, and browser. They must have a way to do unified notification channels. Just thinking out loud.
Okay. Thank you.
How about, sorry, I was on and off the meetup. How about Knative, like Google has a Cloud Run as their implementation. Does Azure have something like that to simplify container management so you don't have to go to Kubernetes?
No, Azure only provides Kubernetes at the moment. They're fully invested in Kubernetes. Yeah.
And there's a few more questions. I think this one was from Daniel. Does Azure have a native implementation like GPS has with Cloud Run? From David, do you have a recommendation for where Azure Containers instances are appropriate?
Yeah, container instances are really appropriate if you want like one, if you have a very simple application that runs in a container. So let's say one website. That's it. No APIs, nothing else. Just one service that can run in one container, basically, and doesn't need a container orchestrator per se. So very simple thing. It's more really to start with containers to get playing. I seldom seen those things actually in production, container instances. You can use them with container orchestrator, container instance, where you then use the container orchestrator, let's say AKS, have that thing spin up and manage those container instances. But then, you know, why would you do that? So, yeah, I think it's more meant for let's get started into containers, let's get used to them, and then move on to the big leagues, AKS, which then is quite a hurdle up, I would say. You know, it's a lot to learn immediately.
Okay. Then one from Roland, he asks, how would you host the files of an SPA app?
Oh, yeah, there's kind of two options there. You have in Azure Storage, Azure Blob Storage, you have the static files feature. You could just put files in there. So static, if it's a static website, SPA app, and then kind of doesn't cost anything, but it then has a little bit of a web server behind it, and it's super fast and it's extremely cheap, but also functionality is not that much, obviously, like authentication is not that much. There's also a feature in Azure App Service, and that is Azure Static Websites, I think it's called. If you look in the portal, you just search for that static websites, you will be able to spin one of those up. And those are way more suited to actually run a static file, a static website in, like a SPA app, for instance, that's only static stuff and doesn't need any server-side stuff. Although a SPA, you know, it could be anything really. That's just something for the front end. So that could also be a server-side Blazor app. Of course, that could also be a SPA. And you could use that anywhere. You can run that in an Azure App Services web app if you want to. But I'm just assuming that you would like a static files website here. Is that right?
Yeah. There all right. Well, yeah, cheers. Thanks, Barry. I think that's it for now. Obviously, as we mentioned a few times throughout the session, it is all recorded. So if you wanted to look through, it will be on our YouTube. I think, Barry, you mentioned that you'd be happy to share the slides as well for those who were happy or wanted to read them again. But yeah, just before, well, I should be posting this on the YouTube tomorrow. And yeah, we've got our next event in 2 weeks. We've got Matteo Emili doing a talk on moving pipelines to code. So I hope all of you can come to that as well. Yeah, thanks, Barry. And thanks, everyone who turned up.
Thank you. And right, the promotion for you. Barry, you'll be doing the same similar talk in March at serverlesstoronto.org. So I hope to see you there, guys, in Canada. So sign up for Barry. March. serverlesstoronto.org.
All right. Thank you, guys. Bye bye.
Wait.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye bye. So.